Hello, welcome to this lecture on the cooperative business model, relevance in today's global environment. My name is Balasubramanian Iyer and I am the regional director for the International Cooperative Alliance, Asia and Pacific. ICA is a global body for cooperatives and we work to unite, promote and develop cooperatives worldwide. In today's lecture, you will come to know about the various elements of cooperatives, its definition, values and principles, see examples of cooperatives working around the world and understand that it's a business model which emphasizes on the social, economic and environmental aspect. The important point is that it's a business model. The difference is the ownership and the way in which profits are shared. So let's get started. These are some brands I'm sure some of you all will recognize. The model in the middle is the Amul girl, who come out with very topical ads whenever an important event happens. Amul is the brand of the Gujarat Cooperative Milk Marketing Federation, which is based in Gujarat. They were formed in the year 1946 and have close to 15 million members in dairy farmers in Gujarat. To the top right, if you are a soccer fan, you'll be familiar with FC Barcelona. Barcelona club is a cooperative. It was formed in the year 1899 and it has close to around 140,000 members who determine the direction which the club takes. To the bottom left is AP. It stands for the Associated Press, which was started in 1836. And in New York, a group of newspapers owners came together and said that it's difficult for us to be sending our reporters to every part of the world. Why don't we pool our resources together and see how we can combine and benefit from it. And that's how the AP was started. It's a very reputed news outlet, having won numerous Pulitzer Prizes in the world. And to the bottom right, if you're an outdoor enthusiast, the REI would be something familiar. They are an outdoor equipment company, started as a cooperative in 1938, and they have close to 18 million members around the world. And finally, to the top right, is the Co-op store at Harvard University and at MIT. And the Co-op store was started as a cooperative in the year 1832. And even today, even though it's not a full cooperative, you can still become a member for it paying $1, the same amount that you paid in 1832. So these are examples of cooperatives worldwide, and a common element running through all of them is that they are based on a need, group of people coming together, identifying need and saying how we can work together. The International Cooperative Alliance was established in 1895 to advance the cooperative model worldwide. We are a member-based organization and today we have close to 309 members from across 109 countries. And these cooperatives are across all sectors of the economy. You name any sector, be it agriculture, health, education, housing, insurance, banking, cooperatives are present in them. Totally, we have close to 1.2 billion members in the more than 3 million cooperative enterprises which are in the world. What that means is one in every six person in the world is a member of a cooperative. And every year, ICA comes out with the World Cooperative Monitor, which ranks the top 300 cooperatives in the world. And these top 300 cooperatives together have an annual turnover of close to $2.1 trillion, which would make them the seventh or eighth largest economy in the world. So cooperatives, as we can see, have a long history, they have a wide presence, they have significant numbers and they have also the economic power. The challenge, despite all this, is the awareness about the cooperative model. I'll come to that later. But now let's look at how cooperatives started and their how do we define a cooperative. In 1844, at the height of the Industrial Revolution, workers were finding it difficult to meet their day-to-day expenses. And so a group of them in Rochdale decided to come together. 14 of them came together and said that, why don't we pool our resources? We can then go to the wholesale market, buy our supplies, come back and distribute it to our members at a much more affordable price. And that's how the Rochdale pioneers started the cooperative movement. Even though cooperatives existed before 1844, the Rochdale pioneers laid down a set of principles on which they would work in terms of being member-based, members economically contributing, members caring for each other and the community. So these principles were established, and that's what the cooperative movement has been building on since then. Around the same time when the Rochdale pioneers were setting up their consumer cooperative in the UK, in Germany you had the credit cooperatives being established. So you had Schulz Deitsch, who in 1852 started the urban cooperatives. Friedrich Raphaelsen started the rural cooperatives around 1884. The Raphaelsen model is much more better known compared to the other models. And similarly, in France, you had the agricultural cooperatives start. And when we take India, the Cooperative Societies Act came about in 1904. And this was set up to ensure that farmers who were indebted to usurious money lenders were able to get a credit source to meet their needs. And that's the important point again about cooperatives, which I mentioned earlier, that it's based on need. A group of people come together, identify a particular need and see how we can work together. The ICA is the owner of the statement of cooperative identity, which has the definition of cooperatives, which has the values and the set of principles. And this was the cooperative statement of identity was firmed up in 1994 at a congress which was held in Manchester in the United Kingdom. The Rochdale pioneers started the laid out the set of principles, but over time, based on needs, the principles have been refined, or how they fit to current times have been further defined through the guidance notes. And in 1995, ICA ensured that the statement of identity was looked into and revised. And so how do we define cooperatives? A cooperative is an autonomous association of persons united voluntarily to meet their common economic, social and cultural needs and aspirations through a jointly owned and democratically controlled enterprise. So in short, a cooperative is an association of people coming together on their own. They identify their need, and this need could be economic, it could be social, it could be environmental, it could be any type of need. But then they work together in a democratic manner. They contribute. A cooperative, unlike a non-profit organization, in non-profits, you need to depend on a donor to contribute, be it government or a foundation. But in the case of a cooperative, members need to contribute. They need to make an economic contribution and ensure that the cooperative is an ongoing concern. And they have to do it in a way that each member is recognized, each member takes active part. And that's what distinguishes cooperatives from, say, a non-profit or the private sector. The cooperative values emphasize self-help, self-responsibility, democracy, equality, equity, solidarity, all in the spirit of honesty, openness, social responsibility, and caring for others. And in this, we have the seven cooperative principles on which cooperatives worldwide operate. And these seven principles include: 1, voluntary and open membership. This means that a cooperative needs to be open. It can't differentiate on the basis of gender, social or political or religious discrimination. So it's a voluntary and open membership. The second is democratic member control. And this is important for in a cooperative. Every member, it's not just enough, good enough to be a member, but as a member, you have to actively participate. You have to actively contribute in the direction which the cooperative takes. And so each member has one vote. It's one member, one vote. And this is the way in which a cooperative is differentiated from, say, the private sector. In the private sector, you have the investor come in, they bring in their money. And so the number of votes which they have is based on the money which they come in. But in a cooperative, it doesn't matter how much money you put in, but as one member, you get one vote. And this is a very important differentiation of cooperative from other enterprises. The third principle is member economic participation. Each member has to actively contribute money. You have to buy shares, you have to not only buy shares, but also if you're a consumer cooperative, buy products. So you have to patronize the cooperative. So as a member, you need to ensure that you put your capital in, and this is important. So you're invested in it. You're an owner in the cooperative, and so economic participation is important. The fourth principle is around autonomy and independence. So cooperatives have to stay independent and have a free hand in which they operate. Even if they say got money from the government, it has to be in terms that doesn't impinge on their authority. You can't have someone from the outside determining what the cooperative should be doing. So autonomy is a very important principle as far as cooperatives go. The fifth one deals with education, training and information. As a cooperative member, you are expected to play a very active part in the management, in the governance of the cooperative. So as a member, you should know what your roles and responsibilities are. As a staff or as a member of the board, you should know what your responsibilities are. So education and training is a very important part of what cooperatives are. And information, you need to let the public know, young people know what cooperatives are. So how do we promote, how do we inform the public is the fifth principle. So education, training and information is important. Cooperation among cooperatives is the sixth principle. It's cooperatives, like I said before, work across a number of sectors. How do we ensure that a cooperative ecosystem survives? So cooperation among cooperative, this could be in terms of a credit cooperative supporting an agriculture cooperative supporting a consumer cooperative and developing the ecosystem. So cooperation among cooperative is the sixth principle. And the seventh principle is concern for the community. While cooperatives are member-based, they also need to take care or be concerned about the community in which they work. So that's why this has been enshrined as the seventh principle. So these are the seven principles on which cooperatives work. And anywhere in the globe you go, you enter into a cooperative and you'll see that they have the seven cooperative principles plastered on the wall or in a strategic location. So that reminds them of what cooperatives are and the principles on which they work. So let's now look at some examples from the world across about the different types of cooperatives. In most countries, agriculture is the major source of livelihood for the people, and agriculture is an important sector because it contributes to the GDP of a country. And agriculture cooperatives are popular, be it in India, Bangladesh, you go in any country of the world, agriculture cooperatives are prevalent. And the picture you see here is from Japan. You have the J group in Japan, which is the body which supports, develops agriculture cooperatives in Japan. And when you see this picture, you can see that it's very member driven. The JA group and agriculture cooperatives in Japan keep the member at the center, and they look at what are the farmers' needs and how can we see that their needs are fulfilled? While the farmer does farming, they have various needs which the cooperative then steps in and fulfills. For example, in the picture on the top you see farm guidance. So the cooperative provides guidance on what crops should be sown, what they should be, type of fertilizers and thing they should be, farmers should be using. Once the farmer produces, they also have support for marketing, they also do processing, and they also ensure that credit is available to the farmer. There are farmer markets open. Then they also ensure that the farmer's health needs are taken care of. They provide insurance, they provide medical service, they have newspapers. So this is a very good example of an agricultural cooperative and how it's working to meet the needs of the farmers, not only on the production side, but also on the marketing side and also on their daily needs. The second example, this is from India. This is a labor cooperative. It's called the Oralungal Labor Contract Cooperative Society. This is in Kozhikode in Kerala. And this was formed in 1925 by 14 individuals. And these 14 individuals were contract laborers. Even today, I think if you go to a rural area in India and you see that road work is going on, there will be laborers sitting on the side of the road and breaking stones which can then be laid for the road. And these 14 stone worker breakers joined together and formed the Oralungal Labor Contract Cooperative Society or ULCCS. And this is India's most successful labor cooperative. It's, if you can see the figures here, from rupees 500 million, they have now rupees 10 billion company with turnover. They are an ISO certified cooperative and the laborers in this cooperative earn higher wages than the lowest grade employee of the government, and every member gets a bonus, medical allowance and gratuity. And the ULCCS success lies in its culture, value and management. The culture which has been ingrained based on cooperative principles which they had when they were started in 1925 continues to this day, and that's something they have solidly adhered to, and they give a lot of emphasis on democracy, equality and equity. And the picture which you see is the software cooperative park which the ULCCS set up, and this is India's first software cooperative park. And they set it up to show that cooperatives can not only look at the interests of the labor, but they can also look ahead and be relevant. If technology is something which drives the economy, they want to be there. So this is a labor software cooperative park which they established a few years back. Cooperative bank, this is an example from Netherlands. It's the Rabobank. This was set up in the late 19th century by Dutch farmers who wanted to modernize their farming, but then they had very little credit and they had problems getting credit from money lenders. So they decided that why don't we come together, pool our resources and set up a bank, and that's how it started. And it's one of the largest cooperatives in Netherlands today with nearly 2 million members, and it works on four qualities in their products and services: customer participation, long-term relationship, sustainable society and having a solid basis. And in 2017, they had a net profit of €2,674 million. So this is an example of a cooperative bank. This is an example from Canada. This is the Mountain Equipment Cooperative. And this was started by six students in 1971. And these six students were interested in outdoor activities but were finding it difficult to get the right kind of gear, be it clothes, be it equipment which they wanted. So they said, why don't we set up a cooperative which can fulfill these outdoor requirement needs? And they pooled together a total of $65 and set up this cooperative. And today it provides outdoor equipment with a low markup and is operated on democratic principles. 48 years after they were set up, MEC today has around 5.4 million members, and they share the original philosophy on which they were set up. And a lifetime membership today costs $5, the same that it was in 1971. And MEC is widely recognized for its commitment to sustainability. And if you go to their website, you can find this. They say that we strive to make great products that lessen our impact on the environment and improve the lives of the people that we work, that we touch. So this is MEC in Canada. This is an example of a women-run cooperative from Korea. It's called iCorp Korea. It has close to 260,000 members. 95% of them are women. And this cooperative was again set up by a group of women who said that we have to go and every day go to the market and make purchases and pay a high price. Why don't we come together and pool our resources so that we can go to the wholesale market? We can also buy quality product. These women were young women who had young children, and so they were concerned about having quality product, safe product. So they said that will be our focus. So, and that's how it started. And if you can see, it has a lot of similarity with the Rochdale pioneers who came together based on a need. And today, iCorp is one of the leading cooperatives in Korea. Capricorn is another example from Australia. And this is an interesting cooperative. It was set up by a group of service station owners. And these service stations are similar to what you would find in India. You have a lot of auto mechanics. These could be mechanics who repair our cars or scooters. Similarly, these service station owners in Australia, in 1974, a group of them came together and said, look, we are spending a lot of time going behind suppliers, trying to get a discount, trying to see what best price we can get. We are spending a lot of money in terms of running around. We are also spending a lot of time in keeping track of expenses, keeping track of paperwork. So why don't we come together and form a cooperative which can take care of some of these needs and let us focus on our core work, which is repairing vehicles. And that's how it started in 1974. And today, it has 17,000 members from across Australia and New Zealand and has a turnover of close to 1.86 billion Australian dollars. And their core approach is again that the needs of members are better managed, save time for them, and ensure that they are able to focus on their core business. And this is Capricorn in Australia. So as you can see, cooperatives are across in any continent that you look at, cooperatives are present. You look at any sector for an economy, cooperatives are present. But the essential element or what differentiates them from other form of enterprises is the principles on which they work, which essentially are being focused on the member, where the member economically contributes, where the member is the owner and takes part in the decision making. And so the cooperative model has been recognized by the governments, by various international bodies. In India, if you take India as an example, it's the fundamental right of citizens to form cooperatives. It's enshrined in our constitution. If you take countries like Nepal and Iran, cooperatives are recognized as the third pillar. You have the private sector, you have the government, and cooperatives are the third pillar. In many other countries, cooperatives again are recognized in various forms by the government because they see that cooperatives can address not only the economic needs but also the social need and the community needs in a way which is participative, which gives ownership, which creates wealth for people. So it's been recognized. Similarly, the International Labour Organization, which advocates for labour rights, it's a tripartite organization which has the government, employers and the workers. And the ILO, right from its inception, it celebrates its 100th year this year. And right from its inception, they have recognized cooperative. They've said that the cooperative model meets the social and economic needs of people, and so they need to be promoted. So in 2002, they came out with recommendation 193, and this essentially asks governments to promote cooperatives. They say that cooperatives have the economic, social importance. Cooperatives are have their own distinct identity. Cooperatives need to be treated on par with say the private sector or other bodies. So in short, they want governments to actively recognize the work of cooperatives, and this recommendation urges governments to do that. And many countries, governments of many countries, have taken this seriously and are implementing recommendation 193. The cooperatives, the United Nations has also recognized cooperatives, and in 2012 it declared it as the International Year of Cooperatives. And in recognizing that, it said that rarely has the argument in favor of cooperatives looked stronger. And every year, it's not just 2012 being declared as the International Year of Cooperatives. Every year, the second Saturday in July is celebrated as the International Day of Cooperatives. The ICA wanted to leverage the recognition it received in 2012 as the International Year of Cooperatives to look ahead. And they came out with the blueprint for a cooperative decade. And what this looks at is, what are the elements which we need to look at to ensure that the cooperatives by 2020 are recognized as an important model and which is a relevant model. And so there are five elements. Two are differentiators, what distinguishes cooperatives from other forms. One is the element of participation. Participation is core because as a member, you need to actively take part in the decision making of the cooperative and also contribute economically. So participation is core. Sustainability is another component. When we look at principle 7, which says concern for the community, and if you also look at cooperatives as a business enterprise, they need to be ongoing. So they need to sustain themselves, sustain not just as an enterprise, but sustain themselves for the community. So sustainability and participation distinguish cooperatives from other enterprises. Cooperatives have a distinct identity, and so ICA has taken on itself to see how it can promote the cooperative identity. And if you look at the bottom of all these slides, you'll find the logo COOP, COOP, and this is an identity which ICA wants to promote amongst cooperative worldwide. And if the 3 million cooperative enterprises and 1.2 billion members started sporting the COOP logo, then that would create the identity and awareness about cooperatives. There are two elements which could inhibit or facilitate cooperative development. One relates to the legal framework. Cooperatives don't work in isolation. They are part of the economy. So they need to be there needs to be an environment in which they can thrive. And so how are the legal environment facilitating is important, and this varies from country to country. And similar to the recommendation 193 by the ILO, the ICA is also actively working to ensure that the legal environment is conducive. And capital. Cooperatives essentially have members contributing to it, but many members and raising money through members is limited. So they need to look for other forms of capital or structure themselves in a way that capital can be raised. But they need to do this in a way which protects the cooperative autonomy and independence. So capital and legal framework are the differentiators. So these are the five elements on which the ICA is trying to promote the cooperative business enterprise model. How are cooperatives relevant in today's world? Let's look at how the dominant model is faring, and the dominant model is the market. Oxfam each year before the World Economic Forum in Davos comes out with a report where they look at the state of the inequality in the world. And in 2018, the Oxfam report said that the 26th richest billionaires now own as many assets as 3.8 billion people who make up the poorest half of the planet. 26 people own more than 3.8 billion people. That's a glaring statistic. Also, the report said that the wealth of the more than 2,200 billionaires across the globe increased by 900 billion in 2018. This meant a 12% increase in the wealth of billionaires. At the same time, the poorest lost 11% of their wealth. And this is again, what this shows is the world is failing to tackle poverty. Even though the poverty numbers are decreasing, but in a larger sense, it's failing to tackle poverty. The economy is rapidly changing and leaving a majority of the people behind. So economic inequality is both a political and a moral issue. And free markets in themselves will not automatically deliver widespread poverty. So the dominant model is not faring very well because it's leaving a large percentage of the population behind. The second issue is millennials. We talk about young people. What are young people's needs and aspirations? So the World Economic Forum, it carries out a survey each year where they interview youth to find out what their needs are, what their concerns are, what their aspirations are. And this survey found that among the top 10 concerns which young people are, the top three are climate change, conflicts across different parts of the world, and inequality. These are the three concerns of the young people around the world. And also when the young were asked, what are they looking for in a job? They're looking for an opportunity to make a difference in society. They are also looking at seeing how they can buy local instead of imported goods and services. Sustainable growth is a concern for millennials and a matter of economic common sense. And also the young people, when interviewed, they are more keen on startup and seeing how they can do something on their own. And when we look at these two broad concerns, one, the way in which poor are being rapidly left behind, and the aspirations of young people, the cooperative model can have an important role to play. Because one, it's a startup. A cooperative, if you look at it, is a startup where young people have a common need. They come together, put their own money in, and see how we can address it. So it's a startup which can resonate with young people. Cooperatives provide individual members ownership. Ownership means you're not just working for a wage, but as the asset grows, your wealth increases. So it's a possibility to create wealth. And when we look at these seven principles, there is concern for the community. Sustainability is a part of this. It has education and training. Cooperatives give a voice to young people. They are looking at working at a place where they have a voice. Cooperative provides each member a voice. It's open and it's democratic. So the cooperative model can address the economic needs, it can address the aspirations of young people. And that's why the cooperative model is relevant. When there is growing inequality in the world, cooperatives have the potential to create a just and equal society. When there is a growing gap in access to food and services, agriculture and consumer cooperatives can ensure fair and reliable access to food. When workers want to control the workplace, have a say in the running of the company, have a say in the ownership, then cooperatives provide the opportunity for even a worker to be an owner. In many countries, governments are withdrawing from the public sector. They are cutting back on health, they are cutting back on education, they are cutting back on essential services. Cooperatives have a role to play in creating a more inclusive and compassionate communities. And finally, when the young are looking for being in a place where they derive a sense of purpose, a sense of fulfillment, cooperatives provide the space for people and purpose and not just products and profit. So let's now look at a few more examples to see how cooperatives are fulfilling some of the current needs. And one way they are doing that is through the Sustainable Development Goals. In 2015, the world countries, governments of the world came together and signed the 2030 Agenda for a Better World. And this includes the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And in each goal, there are certain targets, indicators, and the world has set 2030 as a target, as the deadline to achieve these. And in the UN Sustainable Development Goals, cooperatives have been recognized as an important player within the private sector to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And when we look at the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which includes poverty, ending hunger, looking at issues around health, education, consumption, climate action, cooperatives are working on each one of these. So it's not something new for cooperatives, it's how we show the world that we are contributing to the 17 SDGs. The European Union is one of the largest development agencies in the world, and they have come out with their consensus on development, on how they think the European Union can contribute to the attainment of the Sustainable Development Goals. Even in the consensus on development, cooperatives have been recognized as a sustainable business model. And finally, the ILO, 100 years back, they were strong advocates for cooperatives. And today, when they're celebrating their 100th year, they've again recognized cooperatives as an important player. So there is more and more recognition by international bodies, by government, that cooperatives are relevant to address current needs. So ICA, in order to encourage cooperatives to show how they are contributing to the SDGs, has created a platform called www.coopsfor2030.coop, where our members go and make a pledge on in terms of which SDG they are going to contribute to. And this is an example from IFCO. IFCO is one of the largest cooperatives in the world, fertilizer cooperatives in the world. And this is a pledge which they have made in terms of how they are going to contribute to the Sustainable Development Goals. Social cooperatives, I mentioned before that in many countries, governments are pulling back from health, from education. And nowhere is this seen more than in Europe. So social cooperatives have come up in Europe, and they started in the 1980s when privatization and cut in public services were happening. And social cooperatives are essentially, they could be formed by people having certain health issues, disabilities, could be migrants, could be group of educationists. Here, these people who are affected, they are the members. So they come together, form a social cooperative, and then they go negotiate with the city to see how services can be provided. And this is social cooperatives, given the need of health, need of education, given society's aging, are getting more and more active and relevant across a number of countries. And if you look at in Europe, there are more than 11,000 social cooperatives. And this is again the enabling environment which has been created in some of these countries to promote social cooperatives. These days we hear about sharing economy, collaborative economy, and for many of us, we'll be aware, familiar with Uber, Ola, Airbnb. These are essentially platforms, technology platforms, which work through apps. If I need a car to go somewhere, I just get on the app and order, give my destination, and a vehicle arrives. But when you look at the model in which it works, Uber or Ola, it's a very private sector, private driven model. Whereas I, as a consumer and the driver, we are doing bulk of the work. By the way, Uber and Ola are the largest taxi companies in the world, but they don't own a single taxi. It's you and I who are contributing to their growth, and most of the profit which is made will be taken away by the investors. So the driver, he just gets a wage, and I as a consumer, while there is a lot of convenience, a bulk of my money is going to Uber or Ola. So can cooperatives play a role here? And we are seeing more and more platform cooperatives being formed. And this is an example from the US. It's called Up and Go. And this is three cooperatives which have domestic workers. These are workers who go and clean homes. They came together and said that, why don't we set up a platform cooperative? What it essentially means is they've created an app-based system. If I need my house to be clean, I open the app, give my address and the time, and Up and Go will send a worker at the same time to go clean my place. So what's the difference between Up and Go and say Uber and Ola? When you look at it, fair wage. The workers of Up and Go, they earn more than $4 to $5 more than similar private sector or cleaning industry workers. So they earn much more. And when you look at others, there are other home service apps. These apps keep more than 20 to 50% of the costs are kept by these app-based services, very similar to what Uber and Ola does. Whereas in the case of Up and Go, 90% of the cost goes to the cooperative and to the workers. And as the cooperative grows, the workers get their profit, so they are also building their assets. So Up and Go is a classic example of a platform cooperative which is working on a technology-based model. So this is something which is relevant and growing in many countries. And finally, there are initiatives underway for cryptocurrencies. We heard about Bitcoin, you heard about blockchain. So in Europe, there is effort underway to create what they call the Faircoin Cooperative. And these are similar to Bitcoin, but then it works in a model that it's whoever contributes to it, is part of it, is able to share. And the advantage of Faircoin would be that you could use it in any cooperative you go. You could use it if you wanted to hire a ride-share cooperative, you could use Faircoin, you could go to a store, use the Faircoin. So you're creating an ecosystem of cooperatives. So these are examples of how cooperatives are trying to see, stay relevant to address needs which people have these days. While the cooperative model is a very relevant model, it can meet current needs, it also needs to look at some of the issues which could keep it from growing further. Right at the beginning, I said that cooperatives are over 125 years old, we have a long history, we have a presence, we have the economic clout, but the awareness is very limited. This is because cooperatives is not part of the school curriculum. Even though cooperatives are businesses, business schools don't teach about cooperatives. So as ICA, we think it's one of our responsibilities to see how the cooperative model can be, awareness can be increased. And many of us use cooperative products on a day-to-day basis. For example, in India, people have milk every day, either directly or in their tea or coffee. And the milk comes from cooperatives. Not many people know about that. The house where we stay is part of a cooperative, but then again, that's not very well recognized. So the awareness needs to be increased. And for that, I think cooperatives need to go out and engage younger generation, the interest of younger generation. Like we saw in the survey, young people are looking to work at a place with a purpose, are looking interested in startups. I think cooperatives can fulfill this. So we need to reach out to them, go to schools, colleges, universities, and talk about cooperatives, get them engaged. Cooperatives in many countries can be either bottom up, where people come together and see how they build the cooperative, or they can be top down. For it's a good, cooperatives are a good way to bring a group of people together, especially in rural areas. And that's why agriculture and credit cooperatives are very prevalent in many countries. While this is good, it also creates a base for politicians to come in. It can be a good stepping stone to have, if someone has their political aspirations. It's not that politics should not be there in cooperatives, but then how it's, it can't be too political. So how do we ensure that the member autonomy, member participation is taken, takes place in the way it should? So we need to curb some of the political interference. Governance is a big issue, because being a member of a cooperative is not easy. You have your responsibilities, you have a part to play, and so it's not just you pay and then you be passive. So it's difficult. So we need to educate. We need to educate the member, we need to educate the board of directors, we need to educate the staff to ensure that the governance of the cooperative is done in adherence to the principles. Participation, which is again linked with governance. People are busy these days, they can't contribute time and resources, but in this environment, how do we not lose sight of the cooperative principle of participation is important. Cooperatives also need to professionalize. I think traditionally cooperatives have been looked at as rural, have been looked at as more in traditional industries like agriculture and rural credit. But as we've seen from the different examples from across different countries, cooperatives can fit any sector. You name technology, cooperatives can be formed. Energy cooperatives can be formed. You can form any type of cooperatives, but all of them require professional staff, need to be professional. And if you're professional, you can attract young people. So how do we professionalize ourselves? That's important. Technology, I think, is something which we can't do away with. It's becoming more and more core to what the work that we do. So how do we adopt technology so that we can be more efficient and meet needs of our members? And finally, I think we need an enabling environment. Cooperatives don't work in isolation. They need a level playing field where cooperatives are treated on par with other private sector players, other type of enterprises. So we need the legal environment, we need the support. So I think there are a lot of work areas in which cooperatives need to be working on. But I think when we look at the larger issue the world is facing in terms of climate change, in terms of inequality, in terms of demographic issues around health, around the meeting the needs and aspirations of young people, the cooperatives model, the cooperative business model with its emphasis on a human-centered approach, which keeps the member at the center, which gives them a voice, which gives them ownership, which looks at their economic, social and environmental needs, which looks at their lifelong education and training, and which has the concern for the community, I think has a very important part, and it's very relevant in the global economy today. Thank you very much for taking the time to view this video and listening to my presentation. I think in case you are interested to know more, you can visit our website icaap.coop or the global website ica.coop, and my contact information will be available, so you can feel free to email me with your questions and we'll be more than happy to respond to it. Again, thank you very much for listening to this lecture.